Okay, I've got the top of the hour on my clock, so we're going to get started. Welcome, everyone. I hope you're having a good day so far. We're going to dive right into the webinar so that there's enough time for questions at the end. And the focus of the presentation today is going to be on ways to help manage stormwater runoff from developed areas with low impact but highly effective landscaping elements. The ideas that are presented will follow the accepted practices for green infrastructure and low impact development. So I'm your host, Sam Justice, and I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of Wisconsin with degrees in civil and geotechnical engineering. I'm one of the engineers here at Presto Geosystems, and we're a company that manufactures erosion control, stormwater management, and porous pavement products. We're located in northern Wisconsin, and we work all over the US and the world on a wide variety of projects. So a quick description of who we are for those who may not know. Presto Geosystems worked with the US Army Corps of Engineers to develop the geocell technology in the late 1970s, and we continue to be a leader in innovation in the geosynthetics industry. We offer more than just a product. We're going to work with our customers from the initial concept phase through construction to support a successful project. We have a worldwide distribution network experienced not only in the geocell technology, but other geosynthetics as well. And our assistance does not stop when the product leaves our door. We're going to help you all the way to the end. So we operate in four main product areas using our GeoWeb geocells. And so those are going to be in load support, slope and channel protection, and then constructing green retaining walls. And then we also have a porous pavement division where we have both vegetated and aggregate solutions. And then finally, lightweight reusable construction mats. So we're going to cover a few of those areas today, including our porous pavement products and using the GeoWeb system for channel protection and building green retaining walls. Got to have some learning objectives. So here's some of the things that I hope you get out of the presentation today. So learn what low impact development and green infrastructure means for different project sites and how those regulations can be handled. And then we're going to get into some different applications that follow those guidelines, including cover porous pavements, vegetated swales, and living green walls. So if there are questions during the presentation, type them in your questions tab under your main GoToWebinar file, and then I'll get to those once the presentation is over and we can talk about anything you need in more detail. So green infrastructure, it's about how people can harness nature and use it as an infrastructural system. So the point of green infrastructure, or GI, is to figure out construction and building techniques that work with the water cycle and help keep stormwater under control in our developed areas. And then on the other side, we have low impact development, LID. So LID is an approach to land development or redevelopment that works with nature to manage stormwater as close to its source as possible. LID also emphasizes conservation and using your on-site features to protect water quality. And so we want to do that for the long term. So green infrastructure and LID have similar goals related to land planning and design that include ways to reduce stormwater runoff and help promote natural water infiltration in our ever increasingly built up environment in the most natural way possible. We want to work with nature to do what it needs. So some common examples of green infrastructure and LID systems are going to be things that you may have seen but not realize what they are. So this could be rain gardens that are built to absorb runoff from pavements and parking lots. You could also have bioswales, which are basically vegetated swales, and green medians along parking structures to allow for that immediate water infiltration along roadways. You can also have things like green roofs to help control the temperature and water flow of new or renovated buildings. And then also porous pavements, which allow for immediate infiltration in your parking areas, also along access roads and walkways. So reducing a site's overall environmental impact can help reach your green infrastructure, low impact development, and other green building goals when you're building in protected or densely populated areas. It can also help you meet stormwater regulations that may limit the amount of hard surfaces that you have in your communities. The amount of impervious surface allowed on a project site is often a concern along shorelines, in areas that have high water tables, and in newly built residential areas, although probably should be considered for every project going forward. So with green infrastructure and LID practices, there are numerous benefits for vegetated systems. Generally, any vegetated system benefits by creating a highly aesthetic natural green space in your community with park-like settings with the double intention to help promote that infiltration of stormwater. Additionally, vegetated surfaces are much cooler compared to asphalt or concrete pavements, so you're reducing the heat island effect that's pretty inherent when you have cities or highly built up areas. You're making it cooler and just more comfortable space to be in. So first, let's focus on porous pavements, the options that are available, the benefits they have, and how they can be integrated into low impact development design. So the regulatory market has been driving the need for porous pavements for the last 10 to 15 years. A couple things, one being high stormwater management value, which is going to be the desire to make the best use of valuable high cost land and reduce the need for stormwater ponds or other stormwater infrastructure by increasing the porosity of your pavement. And the other one is going to be things like your regulations. So 40 years later, the Clean Water Act continues to create the need for stormwater management for both quantity and quality. And then also most states have developed non-point pollution regulations with specific targets that need to be met. So those can be even more stringent if you're in a protected area, like near a wetland or a water source. Using porous pavements is going to be one way to meet these criteria while still performing in a structurally meaningful and long-lasting way. And sustainable solutions are going to be really popular with the public right now because you have a high percentage of recycled materials, you're reducing the landfilling because you are recycling, and you can achieve some green building credits. So all good things that give you, you know, a little bit of PR boost with the public. So you do have a couple options. The first is going to be the more traditional and maybe the more well-known option for porous pavements, which is to use the porous version of traditional pavements. So porous concrete, porous asphalt, or permeable paver blocks. These applications allow for normal traffic frequency use. They have increased infiltration over their impervious versions, and that can help with stormwater requirements. And the hard surface porous pavements like these are going to act pretty similarly to their non-porous counterparts. So you know how asphalt works. Porous asphalt is going to be kind of similar, but they do tend to suffer from some durability challenges. So the biggest difference between your standard pavement and a hard surface porous pavement is going to be in the cross section. All three of these methods have deeper cross sections than the standard pavement section and require a special choker or bedding course between the pavement surface and your open graded base layer. This choker layer is intended to be both the leveling layer for the surface pavement, ensuring a smooth and proper surface, and then it's also intended to provide the resistance to movement or differential settlement that could damage the surface. So it has an important function, but it can be costly and time consuming to install properly. And I mentioned durability challenges, so we have to talk about those. And so these are challenges compared to your traditional pavements. So cost is going to be one of the biggest factors, both during installation and over the lifetime of the project. During construction, These products need specialized materials to create the pavement and specially trained contractors who know how to properly install this type of system. There are a lot of long-term maintenance requirements as well. You have to perform regular deep cleaning, such as vacuuming and power washing, to reduce potential clogging, which happens when you have high traffic areas, so your drive lanes. And then you also have to go back and do a lot of resurfacing or replacement of lost material due to raveling, which occurs because there are weak bonds between the materials. It's a really common way to see these types of pavements fail. And that choker course that I mentioned, that actually impedes the water flow. So it reduces the infiltration capacity and speed of the system and leads to ponding at the surface, which is kind of the opposite of what we're going for when you want a porous pavement. So things to keep in mind. So the other type of porous pavements that are out there are going to be molded from high density polyethylene, so a plastic system. So instead of adaptations of a solution that already exists, this is a type of solution that's designed from the ground up to function as a porous pavement. So these are molded paver units that have strong rigid walls and are designed specifically for either a vegetated or a gravel surface. And this is the type of porous paver unit that we offer at Presto Geosystems. So like I mentioned, there are two different surface types that can be used. You can either have topsoil with vegetation, or you can have gravel for a stone surface. The rigid porous pavement systems work well with both options, so it's just up to you to decide what you need on your site. The biggest difference between the two options, besides how they look, obviously, is going to be the amount of vehicle traffic that they're able to withstand. With a vegetated system, vehicle traffic should be occasional, think one or two times a week. This is because no matter how great a system is, grass just doesn't like to be driven on. Too much time getting crushed under cars is going to kill the grass. The system's still going to work, no issues there, but you won't have that nice green lawn that you might have been hoping for. If your pavement is planning to see daily use, aggregate stone infill is going to be the way to go. We call it a non-bound aggregate because there are no glues or resins or binders that are needed to hold the stone together, just the paver unit itself. So with two different paver options available, depending on what type of infill you choose, the first one we're going to look at is the vegetated system. We call it geoblock. So the geoblock system is that rigid porous paver unit, meaning that the panels are not meant to bend or twist. And this rigid nature means that a nice thin cross section is possible. And it's going to be a stronger system compared to those that might be made of geotextiles or a traditional pavement like concrete. An important aspect of the geoblock vegetated unit is that there's a large amount of open space at the bottom of each cell. You can see it in that photo there. So that allows for full root penetration. So the grass surface is going to be thick and uniform. The cells are filled with topsoil or sod and then vegetated so that the grass grows above the cell walls, so you're not going to see any plastic material. The uses for the geoblock grass paver are, like I said, meant to be those occasional uses, one to two times a week. So think things like fire and utility lanes, access roads to infrequently used options, special event or overflow parking at concert venues or churches, stadiums, things like that. Basically, anywhere that you don't anticipate vehicle traffic every single day. So then we also have the aggregate option. We call it geopave. So I know that might cause some confusion with the vegetated geoblock name, so I'm going to try and help keep you on track. So the geopave aggregate units are going to be really similar to those vegetated units, have the same rigid paver characteristics, but there's one specific feature that I really want to highlight that's needed for the performance when using stone infill. And so this is going to be this monolithic mesh bottom. You can see it in the photo here, that really fine grid that's at the bottom of the cells. And so this is on the bottom of the paver unit, and it's compared to that wide opening with the vegetated unit. You want the wide opening so grass can go through. When you're using stone, you actually want to have this mesh, and that keeps the stone from migrating underneath the system, which would cause failure. You don't want the stones to get under the paver units. You want them to stay confined within each one of these blocks. So this mesh helps spread the load of your vehicles, helps keep those stones confined, and it's going to make it so that you have a very low maintenance system that's not going to see things like ruts or wheel wells, divots, that sort of thing. So these units were designed specifically to work with different types of stone, as long as it's pretty small, so that you can have the look of a gravel surface that you're going for. So there are some good applications for the GeoPave aggregate system as well. Again, there's no traffic frequency restrictions with the stone surface. You can drive on it all day, every day. So think parking lots or drive lanes in parking lots. You could also do road shoulders if you want to try and extend your or widen your road or extend it to give a little more space, or any sort of pull-off areas if you need to have like an emergency pull-off area on your road. That's a good application. And it's also good for trails and sidewalks. It's pretty easy to walk on. It is ADA compatible. So if you've got a wheelchair or crutches or particularly high heels that day, this is still very easy and smooth and comfortable to walk on. So just a couple different options that you could possibly use this for. So with that, we can talk about some of the pretty extensive benefits that exist when using porous pavements in green infrastructure and LID land planning. So the cell walls of the GeoPave aggregate unit are meant to be visible. And so they were designed with a herringbone pattern, similar to a paver stone aesthetic. Additionally, the stone infill color can be varied to create a sense of separation, which is useful for walkways, parking lots, road shoulders. So you can see that in the right-hand photo. You're meant to see all of those plastic lines. With the geo-block vegetated system, you're going to have full vegetation growth with that natural lawn look, so the cell walls are not visible through the grass. So depending on what type of look you're going for, you can achieve that with one of these products, and you're not going to have that sort of unfinished falling apart look that you would with things like porous concrete or porous asphalt. So the photo on the right, the GeoPave stone unit, is actually at a wellness retreat in Door County, which is in northern Wisconsin. And so they used it to achieve LEED Silver on their site, due in part to stormwater storage that was utilized within this system. And then the office building on the left is in Florida, and they use that for a fire access lane. So it looks like a normal lawn area, but when an emergency were to happen, fire trucks could go through this area and reach the back of that building. So definitely a good thing to have. So porous pavement systems offer significant storage of stormwater in the cross section as it moves into the groundwater system. Because the water infiltrates through the system, there's going to be minimal sheet runoff at the surface, reducing your flooding potential on and around your pavement. And the aggregate system, like the GeoPave units, have a high percentage of open area and utilize a highly permeable open graded aggregate infill. So the stormwater infiltrates exceptionally fast. And vegetated systems, like the GeoBlock units, help keep the topsoil loose and protected from compaction. So that allows the water to infiltrate faster than a typical vegetated area. So you're not compacting the soil, which would prevent water movement. So our rigid paver units align well with traditional or existing asphalt pavements. So you can see that here. This is a car dealership parking lot that they wanted to extend. This is done in Brooklyn, New York. So the paver units do come in rectangles, but they can easily be field cut to handle curves, existing structures such as manholes, and other typical obstacles that are on site. So the aggregate geopave and the vegetated geoblock units work well in concert with a hard surface impervious pavement. And they're going to be considered so porous that they can actually handle the sheet runoff from those adjacent impervious parking areas. So this is a great way to add additional parking spaces while still meeting your stormwater requirements at your site without the need to create more stormwater infrastructure, such as drainage swales or detention ponds. So here we have a typical cross section of the geopave aggregate system. The geopave unit is 2 inches deep, so the depth of the overall system is going to depend on the amount of base course that's required. There are a variety of factors that decide the depth of your base course, but typically you're going to see about 2 inches underneath, sometimes more if you have very high loads expected. Additionally, depending on the native subsoil, a geotextile separation layer may be required. Note that there's no need for a choker or that bedding course underneath the geopave unit, so there's no layer that's going to limit the stormwater infiltration. Everything is going to be able to flow right through. So one of the biggest factors in determining the base depth is going to be the strength of your subgrade soil, expressed as the California bearing ratio, the CBR of the soil. The higher the ratio, the stronger the soil you have. So the strength of the geopave system is enough that even for the highest load rating from ASHTO, HS25 loading, which is going to be your heavy, fully loaded fire trucks, emergency equipment, there's going to be a really low base depth requirement, only 6 inches, compared to 14 inches or more from unreinforced systems. And it is important to note that this table shows minimum depth requirements. You can actually add more base depth underneath the unit if you want to store more stormwater in your system. So we do have a quick tool. It's available for free on our website that is a little bit of a design assistant tool. So it's provides a very basic cross-section, but it can be helpful in the beginning of your design process. And then if needed, you can come to us. We have some additional calculations. We can provide CAD details, some research, things like that, that help sort of soothe regulators' concerns to help you decide if this is going to be the right system for you. But this is a good first step when talking about whether or not to use a porous pavement system, because it can show whether or not there's stormwater storage and how you can use this system. And it does work with all of our porous pavement products, and it's a pretty easy tool to determine which one might be the most appropriate for your site. So, just something that we have available on our website at prestogeo.com. Okay, so case study. Everybody likes seeing these things happen in the real world. So the first one is going to be with the GeoPave aggregate system. And it was a project that was done at the Citadel in South Carolina. And so it had a lot of the typical problems that you can usually solve when using a porous pavement. So close proximity of this parking lot to a saltwater marsh and strict stormwater runoff regulations that limited both the amount of runoff and the pollutants within that runoff were an issue at the site because they were near a critical tidal area. So the client wanted a low maintenance, low environmental impact solution to replace an existing failing asphalt pavement that had become overly compacted and developed alligator cracking and potholes. There also wasn't space or really time at this site to construct a conventional stormwater detention pond above ground, so they needed somewhere else to have the water go. So the rigid gravel pavers, the GeoPave system, were utilized as a low impact solution. Installation is really quite straightforward. The paver units were installed over that non-woven geotextile, and they are connected to form a contiguous interconnected area. So in this case, there wasn't actually any base installed, so the overall cross-section for this project was very thin, just the 2 inches from the unit itself, which meant reduced excavating costs and lower material costs overall. So an open graded aggregate was next. So you basically see you can dump it in piles and then you rake it into all of the open cells so that you get full full infilling and full coverage. Standard lightweight construction equipment is used, no need for any specialty equipment. And the crew, which had no prior experience installing the geopave units, was able to achieve an installation rate of 1,200 square feet a day, including excavation and infilling. So pretty quick. So the open graded aggregate is that highly permeable stone. So it allows water to very quickly collect within the voids of the stone and then drain naturally into your groundwater system without ponding or running off at the surface. If necessary, you can install additional base if you want that more storage underneath. So if you have a clay subgrade, something that doesn't allow for fast water infiltration, you might want more base underneath the units to help hold water while it slowly infiltrates. So something to consider and something that we can help you determine how much you may need for your site. So this porous parking area actually had parking stalls installed next to a asphalt drive lane. And so they were able to collect that stormwater runoff from that impervious pavement section and allow it to infiltrate within these parking stall areas. So a great mixed use area. And then this has actually been in place for over a decade at this point. The lot is still in use, it's used daily, and really looks quite as good as it does the day it was placed. There's very little need for maintenance of the aggregate since it's confined within those geopaved cells. So it's not going to get pushed around. You're not going to see ruts or, you know, those drive lanes or wheel wells forming. There are some recommended tips for keeping it in good shape. Basically, you want to keep the porous pavement areas clear of organics. So you don't want, you know, leaves to fall in the fall and then, you know, start rotting and create a barrier over the top of the system. So you just want to, you know, rake or leaf blow those away. And then snow, winter weather conditions. I know that's definitely a concern for, you know, half the country, half the world, you know, winter conditions. So it's pretty easy. There's two options. You can either use a rubber plow boot. It's a pretty common accessory to put on the bottom of the plow blade, and then you can plow like normal. If you don't have that rubber boot, you actually do want to lift the plow blade about a half to 1 inch so that it doesn't come in direct contact with the geopave units. You don't want the plow blade to cause damage to the paver units, essentially. So there are options to plow. You could also obviously shovel the snow away, and you can do things like salt or chemical de-icers, but you just have to keep in mind those will then infiltrate into your groundwater system. So if you have pollutant regulations that you need to follow, might not be the best option. So like I said, I know that placing porous pavements in cold weather or snowy conditions is going to be a big concern for many regulators. So we do have quite a bit of information available on our website answering some of the common questions we see, or you can contact us directly and we'd be more than happy to help alleviate any concerns that you have with that sort of topic. Then we have another case study using a porous pavement system. This time it's going to be the vegetated geoblock system. And this was for a parking and pedestrian walkway area. So this was for the Nattapawassee Huron Band of the Potawatomi tribe. And this was in Battle Creek, Michigan. And so they were going to create or construct a new powwow area. And we're looking to create an area for parking trailers and then, you know, walkways for people to get from this parking area to the powwow ground. So the ground itself was a very soft clay that often caused the heavy trailers to get caught and bogged down and was just really uncomfortable to walk through, you know, constantly, you know, sinking your boots in, getting caught up in the mud, that sort of thing. And so because this was a wilderness area, the NHBP was looking for a more natural look than an asphalt parking lot. They wanted to sort of keep the nature aesthetic. So they used the vegetated geoblock system because it was going to be used pretty infrequently. They're not driving on it every day. So a grass surface would grow in quite nicely. So the system was installed in October of 2019, so that everything was in the ground before the snows came. So the ground was leveled off, and then the geoblock panels were placed, and they were laid in a herringbone pattern, that's going to be just the recommended pattern style for bi-directional traffic, where there's lots of turning and movement, pretty common in trailer parking areas. So there was a little bit of base underneath the system to help with stormwater storage and support of the heavy trailer loads. So they only had a 4-inch total cross section. So still a nice, very thin cross section, doesn't require a lot of excavation, doesn't require a lot of materials to be brought in, but can support those heavy vehicle loads on very soft soils. The cells were actually filled in with this topsoil that had been reclaimed during the excavation process. So they were able to save a little bit on, you know, material and hauling costs by just reusing that salvaged material from on site. So nice little benefit. And so this is what the system looks like immediately after that soil is in place. So you can actually start driving on the system right now, because you're going to be driving on the actual plastic of the geoblock panels, not on the topsoil. So even though the grass isn't in yet, this is still now a functional parking area. And then here we are in the summer of 2021, so about 2 years later. So the geoblock panels are no longer visible. It's a nice, healthy looking green lawn. So basically you would never know that this area was reinforced if you didn't already know. So now it's a parking lot for those cars and trailers, and it's safe for walking and playing on. So with that full grass growth, the lawn can be maintained with a standard lawnmower or landscaping maintenance, you know, simple, no fuss, no muss, nothing special. And then in the winter, when the snow does come, you can either scrape off the snow, like I described before, you know, have that rubber plow, rubber boot blade, or you can just let it build up over time and melt like a normal lawn. So depends on what you need this area for. Okay, so that was porous pavements. So now we're gonna switch gears a little bit and talk about stormwater channels. So this is another way of reducing your runoff and integrating green infrastructure into your designs with swales and vegetated channels that collect stormwater. So grass swales are a pretty common thing to see. When you don't have porous pavements, you're going to have that sheet runoff. It needs to be collected somewhere. Put it into a swale like this. So it helps collect that water, slows it down, and lets it infiltrate, or you can direct it into storm drains. Swales and drainage ditches are typically intended for low to moderate and intermittent flows. So this shouldn't be, you know, a continuous high flow channel area. It's really just collecting that stormwater runoff. So this is where we're going to the GeoWeb GeoCell system. So we talked a little bit about that at the beginning. The GeoWeb actually helps confine that topsoil and vegetation in place so that failure through erosion does not occur. So we don't have a lot of time to go into details about how the GeoCell was designed and how it's manufactured. We don't have time for that today, but there's a lot of really good information on our website, prestogeo.com, we're always happy to talk about it if you have general or specific project questions, so feel free to reach out. But just know that the GeoWeb system was the first and is still the leading GeoCell product on the market today, and it's really going to be the best option if that's the way you're choosing to go. So like I said, if you have any technical questions, please feel free to reach out. So we did do some testing with the GeoWeb system at Colorado State University to show how the GeoCells function in channel and embankment applications. Vegetated channels can be designed for higher flows when they're stabilized with the GeoWeb GeoCell technology. So the improvement's actually incredibly high, up to 30 feet per second compared to 5 to 6 feet per second when the soil is just on its own. So massive improvement. And so this allows for lower impact vegetated channels to be used instead of expensive, high maintenance riprap concrete or articulated concrete block channels. So you have the nice green lawn, looks a little nicer, better for the environment, and it can still handle those high flows that might be seen. So if you are interested in that testing, we have a lot of good research coming out of that. This was done by Dr. Chris Thornton, who is a leading expert in this type of research. And so we have that information available on our website, and we can always talk through it if you have specific questions. So just an extra little piece of information that you can have to convince people that this is a system that works. You know, we're not, you know, talking ourselves up here. We have the research to back it up. Okay, so here's a pretty common example of an erosion that can happen in an unprotected roadside ditch, and then what the repair looks like with the GeoWeb solution. So notice in the before picture, you have a lot of erosion. You're seeing, you know, those rills and gullies. Grass is kind of patchy, just doesn't really look very nice. And then you go to the GeoWeb system, and the water can now flow over the system without damaging the road. You're not gonna have any undermining of the road, so it's gonna have less maintenance. Vegetation can grow in better, and you can direct that stormwater to wherever you need it to go. So nice, much cleaner, nice looking solution. And so GeoWeb vegetated channels can also be designed as tiered retaining wall structures. So again, intended for low to moderate and intermittent flows, usually again during stormwater events. And so they can be designed with these tiered retaining walls, so they have a much narrower horizontal footprint, while at the same time accommodating a higher volume of water flow to help mitigate flooding. So this can be really nice if you are trying to fit a channel here between an existing road and a building structure. You maybe don't have a whole lot of space. You can go deeper with these, you know, near vertical walls and still maintain the amount of water flow that you need without taking up a whole lot of space. So again, case studies, always good. So this was a project that happened down in Florida. So the GeoWeb system works great along shorelines of stormwater channels. So placing the panels along a shoreline is gonna help protect against erosion due to that water movement and any potential wave action if you've got a very large channel. And so this project was along a stormwater diversion channel that actually helps move hurricane waters. So during the hopefully infrequent hurricanes, the channel will fully flood. And before this GeoWeb system, there was severe eroding along the channel side slopes every time there was a hurricane that required maintenance, having to come back in, regrade the slopes. Very time consuming, very costly. So you can see there's obviously existing infrastructure on each side of the channel. So it was very important to help try and confine the water to within the banks of the stormwater channel without, you know, being able to really expand the space they had. So the GeoWeb panels are placed both above and below the average water line for this type of project. The panels do need to go below the water line to ensure that they don't get lifted up due to water movements. And that way you're really protecting the entire shoreline all the way down to in a stable channel bed. The area does not need to be dewatered to do this type of installation. The GeoWeb panels by themselves will float, but will eventually be staked down to help hold them in place. And then once you put your infill material in, the system's not going anywhere. And then here you can see there's the final surface after vegetation has been established. The performance of the GeoWeb system allows it to handle some pretty heavy fluctuations in water depth and then the associated velocities along with that, while still preventing erosion on the side slopes. And using a soil and grass type that's going to be local to your area, maybe even using some salvaged material from the excavation process is going to help with blending everything in so the geoid panels aren't noticeable. So the grass is going to grow above the geoid panels. You're not going to see the plastic, but this way it's nicely blended in. You won't even notice that's there. And you can walk along the shoreline without fear of sinking in, and the shoreline is going to be protected against erosion for years to come. And one last thing that I just want to highlight with the geoid system is that you don't actually need to cover the bottom of the channel if you don't want to. It's pretty common actually to just cover the side slopes and not the bottom of the channel. So if you don't want to deal with that, or if you do need large riprap stones for whatever regulation needs, you can do that. And so they actually, in this case, have a liner system, which is this bright yellow fabric that's under there. And so we were able to install the geoweb system over this liner without puncturing it, so that you're not, you know, damaging this impenetrable liner with the system. And then once you fill the geoweb panels in with that topsoil, you can still grow vegetation even over an impenetrable liner because of the soil that's held and protected within the geoweb cells. So now if the stormwater overflow channel does become flooded because of an event, the side slopes are going to be protected and the channel is going to be able to do its job directing water where it needs to go. Maintenance on these systems is really so easy. Lawn mowing can happen if you have regular grass with your standard lawnmower. Again, both walk behind and riding varieties are going to be totally fine, and they're not going to damage the geoweb panels in any way. Or pick a taller vegetation like this, this taller grass, and then no maintenance at all. So it really is going to be a place it and forget it type of system. Okay, last thing we're going to cover today is going to be green walls and how they can contribute to your low environmental impact goals. So the geoweb geocell technology can be adapted to create retaining walls, such as this vegetated levee or those tiered channels that we saw a couple photos back. So basically you were stacking multiple panels of geowebs on top of one another to achieve your required height. And then you allow vegetation to grow over the front face, allowing or creating a living green wall rather than showing a concrete or gabion basket wall that might be a little uglier. So the primary benefit to using a geoweb geocell wall is to create this stable, natural living structure with vegetation for aesthetic appeal. The open front fascia allows rainwater to infiltrate through, and it can absorb runoff from the top of the wall. So if you put it underneath the parking lot, the water can flow over the edge and be infiltrated in through this green living wall without creating, flooding at the bottom. So another way to help manage your stormwater runoff. So the geoweb walls generally are vegetated. We say they create, good living green walls, but they actually can be filled with an open graded aggregate for a permeable aggregate wall. And there's two ways to design them. It's going to be like a similar, anything like a mechanically stabilized earth, an MSC wall. So you can have a gravity system or a reinforced system. So we can help you decide what's going to be most appropriate for your site. There's a lot of different factors that go into that. So it's not as easy as saying, condition A versus condition B. So that's definitely something our engineering team is willing to help you with. But one advantage that the geoweb walls will have over things like block walls or concrete walls is flexibility in poor soil conditions. Their relative lightweight allows them to tolerate reasonable differential settlement very well. And then another advantage over traditional walls is going to be the relative shallow depth of the wall into your slope face. So they aren't going to take up a lot of excavation room, and they can have a very steep wall face, as steep as 80 degrees. So not quite vertical, but really darn close. One last case study, vegetated walls. So this was a vegetated retaining wall below a gravel road next to a small intermittent stream. You can see that the geoweb wall was built up in the overflow area of this stream amid a riprap section that was intended to help prevent erosion. The geoweb wall is placed to provide support for the road that you can see on the right side of the photo. And we don't have a lot of time to talk about the construction of geoweb walls today, but we actually have a full webinar dedicated to talking about how to design geoweb walls. It's available on our website that you can watch. So if you are interested, lots of resources for that. So after the geoweb panels are fully stacked on top of one another and they're filled with soil, the entire wall was coated in hydro seed to promote vegetation growth. There's a lot of flexibility with the geoweb walls. So you can see them being placed around curves. They can adapt to different heights or ground elevations, and they can support some pretty heavy loads when properly designed. So the wall is 100% functional here, just waiting for the vegetation to make it look a little more filled in. So if you choose an aggregate infill rather than vegetation, this would be the final look of the wall, just as a reference note. Okay, so grass is starting to come in nicely just a few months after installation. You can also see that a fence was installed at the top of the wall. So this is an easy thing to incorporate into geoweb walls. So don't let the need for other infrastructure dissuade you from using a geoweb wall. Really quite flexible. So this was about a year after installation. Vegetation is fully established and the geoweb panels are no longer obviously visible. So there's going to be no real maintenance required for a geoweb wall like this, just the occasional visual inspection to make sure impact damage hasn't occurred. So if, you know, vandalism or anything like that. If nothing happens, the geoweb wall is going to happily sit there for the full project lifetime. Shouldn't be any concern. And final very aesthetic photo about 5 years after installation. Pretty picturesque, if you ask me. So this wall will help protect the area in the stream in case it does flood. And then it's also going to protect the fence and the road above the wall. So they're not going to go anywhere. You're not going to have any undermining or erosion issues that you would have to be concerned about. And this is probably the most common outcome for a geoweb wall, that they kind of just disappear into the landscape and hopefully no one even knows they're there. Okay. Covered a lot of stuff today. So in summary, you can see that there are a lot of ways to reduce your stormwater runoff and minimize the environmental impacts from the built-up environment. Using rigid porous paver technology for stormwater management is a great alternative for water collection off roadways and parking lots. And creating green infrastructure with drainage swales or living walls is going to be able to help you achieve your green infrastructure and low impact development goals. We do offer a complete system solution for a wide variety of applications based on your project specific details and conditions. So part of our complete solution is our technical assistance. I've mentioned a couple times, feel free to contact us with any questions. And we do provide a free project design evaluation. The form is on our website. And you fill it out with as much information as you have, including attaching documents such as geotechnical reports, and then it comes to myself and the rest of the engineering team here at Presto. And within 3 business days, but usually a lot faster than that, we do provide a complete design evaluation with everything you need to successfully integrate one of these systems at your site. And we're going to work with you to get the best design for your project. So we're now making it easier and faster for you to obtain your PDH certificates. We do have a new webinar dashboard. So you can easily view our webinars and download PDH certificates for on-demand or live webinars that you've attended. Your personal webinar dashboard is going to keep a record of all of the on-demand webinars that you've watched, along with your PDH credits that you've earned from that. So a link with more information about this webinar dashboard will be emailed to you within the next couple of days. Probably not today, but definitely by the end of the week. So those of you who are in attendance live today, excuse me, will automatically receive a PDH certificate within the next 24 hours. But note that this is going to come from GoToWebinar, not from Presto. So be on the lookout for it. And depending on your company's cybersecurity setup, you might want to check your spam folder at the end of the week if you haven't received that certificate. Okay, so that's what I've got. Here's my contact info at the page. So if you do have questions later, you can feel free to call or email me. Looks like we've got a good number of questions that have come in, so I definitely want to talk about those. Here we go. Let's start at the end. What is maximum batter for geoweb walls? Excuse me. So maximum batter, how steep can that wall face be? And the answer is 80 degrees. So can't quite get to vertical. And that's because you do actually want a little bit of a step back so that you have space for the vegetation to grow. So that step back could be, about an inch. So not very much. And like I said, you can get as steep as 80 degrees. You can go much shallower. You can go as low as 45 degrees with a geoweb wall. But usually between 70 and 80 is going to be the most common. Excuse me. Let's see, some other questions about using the geoweb system for the channels. So how are they secured over that impenetrable liner? One of the photos I showed had that bright yellow liner in it. Obviously, you don't want to puncture those. That defeats the purpose. Excuse me. So what you would do is actually use a tendon system. So these are polyester tendons that are strung through the geoweb cells and then secured at the crest of the slope. So rather than anchoring along the face of the slope, you would do all of your anchoring at the crest of the slope. So this is obviously something that's going to be pretty project specific. And we would definitely be able to help you with that. Our free project design evaluation is going to be the best way to go through that kind of detail if you have a specific project. Okay, some other questions. What about what types of vegetation can you plant within the GLAB system? Make sure that you aren't damaging it. So we do recommend things like grass or small flowering vegetation, things that have a dense root system, but aren't very large. If you were to try and plant things, you know, like an oak tree, that's going to obviously be quite large, going to have a large root ball system. And that's something that would be that you need to take extra precautions so that you don't damage the geoweb system. So if you do want one of those trees, or if you have existing large vegetation that you need to work around, it is possible, and we can help you determine how to either cut or flex the geoweb system around that type of vegetation. But in general, if you have the option, we recommend things like grasses and small flowering vegetation. Let's see, going up to the porous pavement systems. Couple questions about some of the photos that I showed. At the powwow ground, so that was the one that used the vegetated geo block system, they're asking what type of base is installed under the grid. And so this is actually something that has a little bit of flexibility. You can either do just a standard open graded aggregate, or you can do what we call engineered base, which is going to be a mixture of aggregate and topsoil. And you would do this so that you have a little bit of extra topsoil within the base to help that root system grow. And then that still allows for a lot of void space between your aggregate, which is going to store that stormwater. So you have a little bit of some options, a little bit of flexibility, but generally it's going to be that open graded base course, possibly mixed in with a little bit of topsoil. Let's see, some questions about doing some surface work with the geopave system. So basically, how can you make the system be a little more flexible and fit your needs? So specifically, they asked, can you paint the system? So can you paint, you know, parking stall lines on there? And the answer is yes, you definitely can. And really, paint isn't going to affect the overall permeability of the system. You're not going to be painting over the entire system. Painting just parking stall lines is a pretty negligible, you know, amount of surface area. But if you don't want to deal with that, we actually have special, specifically molded, basically clips that install directly into the geopave cells, and they're bright yellow and bright blue. So you can install those as parking delineators, basically, so that you don't have to worry about painting. That way you can sort of make the system work for what you need. You can also do common things like installing curb stops, that sort of thing. So anything that you need sort of on site or on top of the system is acceptable. And it's not really going to affect the overall permeability of the system, because it's going to be a relatively small amount of the surface area that you're covering. So lots of options there, and don't really worry about losing permeability if you do that. Let's see, lots of questions about porous pavements in snowy conditions. Knew there would be, there always are. It's definitely something that a lot of people are concerned about, and rightly concerned about. So basically, you don't really have to worry too much about doing anything that's outside of your normal snow maintenance concerns. So like I said, you can use a snow plow. You really just want to have that rubber plow boot on the bottom. And that boot really just makes it so that you're not going to have adverse impacts between the plow and the geopave aggregate units, because you don't want the plow to accidentally catch an edge, rip the unit out of the ground. Obviously, that's a bad thing. So you can put that plow boot on, plow like normal. You can also, like I said, you can put de-icing salts down. You just have to be aware that, excuse me, be aware that that salt could infiltrate into your groundwater system. Something else to keep in mind is that with the open graded aggregate, because you have those void spaces, you're actually trapping air down there, and that actually helps the latent heat of the system be enough to help melt the snow or any ice that might form across the top of the system. So because you have that air and those void pockets in the base, it helps promote heat to reach the surface, melt that snow and ice so that it gets down into the system and off of your surface so that you can still drive on it. There then obviously with that concerns about ice freezing and expanding in the base. And that's why you do want that open graded aggregate. You want something with that void space to allow the water to freeze, expand, and then not damage the system. So with some basic, excuse me, some basic concerns, you can install these type of parking lots for long term, for both hot and cold weather conditions. So if you do have questions, feel free to contact us. We're happy to help. I'm struggling a little bit, and it is the end of the hour, so I will let everyone go. Thank you so much for attending. If you have a question I didn't get to, we can talk more offline. Feel free to reach out. Be happy to discuss. And then definitely check out that webinar dashboard when it comes to you. Lots of good information about the GWEB system and other applications that it can be used for. Thank you. Have a great day.